Shalom from Israel to all of the Daystar viewers around the world. I'm Moshe Bar Tzvi, the producer and founder of Israel Now News. We at Israel Now News are dedicated to bringing you the full story and the truth about Israel from Israel. It's written in the Holy Bible when David said in Psalm 25:5, "Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long." And God says in Zechariah 8:16, "These are the things that you shall do. Speak out the truth to one another. Judge with truth and judgment to peace in your gates. And always search for the truth, and the truth shall set you free." John 8:31. I hope you enjoyed the program. God bless you from Jerusalem. Shalom, shalom.
Welcome to Israel Now News. I'm Yochanan Elrom.
And I'm Erin Viner.
In our top story, the United Nations has adopted four times more resolutions against Israel than any other member nation. The Jewish state, the only true democracy in the Middle East, was singled out and overwhelmingly condemned by the UN Human Rights Council in an expression of unabashed anti-Semitic bias. The United Nations focused solely on condemning Israel while ignoring despicable practices which are rampant in Muslim countries, such as female genital mutilation and the forced arranged marriage of child brides. Israel is one of the only countries in the Middle East where women have the freedom to vote, drive, and show their face in public. Yet, just a week ago, the UN declared Israel as the world's worst violator of women's rights. The UNHCR ignored real abuses of human rights in Muslim countries, such as the slaughter of Christians and government-sponsored use of chemical weapons against its civilians in its quest to delegitimize the Jewish state. Even North Korea, with its ghastly human rights record, fared better than Israel.
The Nigerian army has stepped up its battle against the Boko Haram militia and is claiming to have freed more than 700 women and children imprisoned by the Islamic terrorist group. Many of the survivors are now recounting horrific stories of sexual abuse, violence, forced marriage, starvation, and murder. Several women say that as the army succeeded in approaching the camp where they were being held, the terrorists executed dozens of hostages rather than allow them to be rescued.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is insisting that it is not too late to stop the devastating nuclear accord that U.S. President Barack Obama is brokering with Iran. Netanyahu warned the international community that it cannot afford to let the planet's foremost sponsor of terrorism have nuclear capabilities. The Israeli leader said the current deal will endanger Israel, the Middle East, and the entire world, and he urged the West to hold out for an agreement which will actually do the job of blocking Tehran's path to the bomb. U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry responded to Netanyahu's appeal by insinuating that the Israeli prime minister was sowing hysteria.
Tensions are heightened in the world's most vital shipping route following Iran's seizure of a Marshall Islands flag cargo ship. An Iranian Republican National Guard naval patrol fired on the Maersk Tigris as it was passing through the Strait of Hormuz before boarding the vessel and taking the crew hostage and detaining the ship in its own territorial waters. The narrow strait is the only sea passage into the Persian Gulf and is the world's most strategic choke point because the Islamic Republic has used its proximity to the area as a vantage point to threaten the movement of the world's oil supply. In response to the threat, the U.S. Navy deployed an aircraft carrier and other large warships to the site to escort American vessels through the strait.
We reported last week on the sinister activity occurring on the Temple Mount under the supervision of the Muslim Waqf and how Jewish artifacts are being systematically dug up and destroyed as part of an organized campaign to erase thousands of years of Jewish history on Mount Moriah. Now a left-wing group of archaeologists is attempting to take one of Jerusalem's most important excavations out of Jewish hands. In 1999, the Israel Antiquities Authority began excavating the City of David, as well as a series of tunnels which stretch from the compound to various locations under the Temple Mount. This dig has yielded artifacts from 10 different ancient civilizations and has provided evidence of events written about in the Bible. Now a consortium of far-left archaeologists funded by European nations is petitioning the Israeli High Court, demanding that the IAA cease excavating and relinquish control of the tunnels. A spokesperson for the El Ad Foundation, which funds the important work at the City of David, said the petition is politically motivated. He accused the leftist group of turning a blind eye to ongoing destruction of Jewish antiquities taking place on the Temple Mount, while at the same time it is attempting to undermine Israel's right to excavate within the City of David. King David's City is one of the most historically significant sites in the country, and artifacts have been found there which prove the 3,000-year bond between the Jewish people and Jerusalem.
Members of Britain's Christian and Jewish communities are fuming over the opening of a play in the United Kingdom they argue distorts the historical account of the siege on the Church of Nativity in 2002. During the Second Intifada, Palestinian terrorists infiltrated the church, considered one of the holiest sites in Christianity, where they held 200 civilians and clergy members hostage for 39 days. During that time, they brazenly rigged the birthplace of Jesus with explosives and used pages of the Christian Bible as toilet paper, according to eyewitness accounts. Now, Salford's Lowry Theatre will host the opening of The Siege in Manchester next week, before the production is set to take to major stages in London and eight other British and Scottish cities. Those familiar with the script are slamming it for glorifying Palestinian terrorists by depicting them as freedom fighters who merely sought refuge inside the church. The most prominent terrorist celebrated in the storyline is Ibrahim Musa Salem Abayat, who commanded a Tanzim terror cell that perpetrated multiple attacks against Israel, as well as the murder of a 71-year-old American peace activist just 3 months before the standoff. Israeli officials and representatives are joining those protesting the production, which is being funded by British taxpayer money through the Arts Council of England.
Hopes were dashed last week when the body of a missing Israeli war hero was discovered in the rubble on Mount Everest. Or Asraf was in Nepal traveling and hiking, as many Israelis do after completing their army service. He was a member of the IDF's Elite Egoz Reconnaissance Unit and was injured in Gaza during Operation Protective Edge last summer. When Orr failed to contact his family after the devastating 7.9 earthquake, his father and members of his army unit flew to Nepal to assist in the search efforts. Our thoughts and prayers are with the Asraf family and with all of the victims of this disaster. Israel is providing the largest humanitarian presence in Nepal, with dozens of teams taking care of the wounded and conducting search and recovery operations. The IDF has established a field hospital where hundreds of Nepalese people have been treated and at least a half a dozen babies were born.
Israeli security officials have issued a severe warning against travel by citizens and Jews of other nationalities to Tunisia at this time, based on concrete intelligence reports. The Muslim nation is a popular destination for many Israelis and European Jews who wish to visit the ancient El Griba synagogue, the graves of several great rabbis, and the small Jewish community still living on the island of Djerba. During a major Jewish holiday in 1985, a Tunisian police officer charged with security at the site instead opened fire on Jews praying at the synagogue, killing three people, including one child. 21 others were killed in a 2002 bombing by al-Qaeda-linked Islamist terrorists on the House of Worship, which is one of the oldest in the world. In a blatant act of discrimination, the Tunisian government barred Israelis from stepping foot in the country while their cruise ship was docked at a national port last year.
A senior IDF official has confirmed that 4-year-old Daniel Tragerman was killed by a rocket fired by terrorists from Gaza from within a UN facility there last summer. The United Nations recently released a report condemning Israel for its conduct during Operation Protective Edge, saying the IDF fired on UN buildings. The Army insisted that the structures were being used to house weapons and harbor terrorists. Lieutenant General Benny Gantz, who was the commander of Israeli Defense Forces during the conflict with Hamas in Gaza, was in Kibbutz Nahal Oz at the time when the little boy was killed. Gantz confirmed that the mortar which struck Daniel's house was fired by terrorists from within a United Nations compound.
A quick-thinking police officer in Texas is continuing to receive widespread praise for saving the public from a potentially massive Islamic terror attack in a Dallas suburb last week. Two masked Muslim men armed with AK-47s and backpacks stuffed with ammunition were shot and killed after they opened fire and wounded a police officer. Authorities believe that the jihadists were intent on massacring those attending an event defending First Amendment rights. The radical Islamic State says that it was behind the attack, which is the first ISIS claim of responsibility for the launching of a terror attack on U.S. soil.
The Jewish state has announced that it has a water surplus. Israel is enjoying an excess of clean drinking water despite being surrounded by deserts and salty seas. This is due to the implementation of technologies which provide conservation and create fresh water. Israel was proud to announce that in 2014, 35% of the country's domestic use derived from desalinated water. In 2015, Israel expects this number to rise to 40%. The water surplus has several exciting implications for Israel and its neighbors. Water is a huge and extremely expensive commodity in the Middle East, and Israel is considering exporting it. Israeli water tech is already being used to combat the drought in California and to create clean water in the Marshall Islands. This is the latest weapon in the battle against famine. Last week, we reported that the Israeli drip irrigation technology is helping to feed over a billion people in developing nations.
That concludes the news portion of our show. Stay tuned for Ask the Source with Josh Reinstein.
Hello and welcome to Ask the Source. I'm your host, Josh Reinstein, and we're here in a beautiful day in Jerusalem on our rooftop studio. My guest today is Rabbi Yehuda Glick, the chairman of the Temple Mount Heritage Foundation. Rabbi Glick, thank you for being on the show.
My pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
Rabbi Glick, you've been at the forefront of fighting for the rights of Jews and Christians to go out onto the Temple Mount. Tell us a little bit about this movement.
When Christians come to visit Israel, they're not coming to Israel because the Tel Aviv beach shore is the most beautiful one in the world. They come because it's the only place in the world where they can actually walk in the footsteps of the book. And for all the millions and millions of believers of the book, the holiest place in the world is one place, the Temple Mount. And this Temple Mount, we know, has the prophecy that it will become the house of prayer for all nations. Unfortunately, today, it's a center for incitement and hate and terror. And what our goal is to encourage more and more Jews and Christians to come to the Temple Mount and help us turn the place into a house, I would say a world center for religious tolerance. And this is the place should be a house where each and every one of us should be able to pray as a free person.
You know, something that's unbelievable to many is that we have complete freedom of religion in Israel. We can go anywhere and pray in Israel, Jews, Christians, Muslims. Yet on the Temple Mount, it's the one place where the government, even though it's under Israeli control, says Jews and Christians can't pray. How is this possible?
Well, this is possible because we've actually got used to the situation where that Temple Mount is sort of a Muslim territory. But the more and more there will be a demand from the public, Jews and non-Jews, who will say, listen guys, the Temple Mount is holy for all of us, and we demand the right, basic human rights. We have nothing against the fact that Muslims will be praying for that, and no problem. You know, when Isaiah said the Temple Mount will be a house of prayer for all nations, he was talking to a world where all the nations were idol worshippers. And here he says, guys, the Temple Mount will be a house of prayer for all nations, all of those believing in the one and only God. So we call upon the Muslims and we say to them, guys, think how beautiful it would be if we have one place, the center of the world, the place where God says, I rest my divine presence here. And at this place, all those who are faithful in the one and only God will be able to pray and express their service of Hashem together at the same exact place.
You know, according to Israeli law, it's illegal to prevent someone from praying in a holy site, yet the government does prevent Jews and Christians from praying on the Temple Mount. You just took this to the courts here, and you won. Tell us a little about that.
Yeah, government of Israel has, for some reason, ever since 1967, just in a way of not to aggravate the Muslims, have established some kind of status quo, which says, listen, we're not going to allow Jews praying there. But this was okay for many years when there wasn't a demand. Today we have hundreds and thousands of Jews and Christians who want to pray on the Temple Mount. So once I had guided the Torah, I'm a tour guide, I guided the Torah on Temple Mount and I was praying, And it was filmed by one of the Israeli TV channels. And the police saw the broadcast, and they banned me for going to the Temple Mount for 2 years. And I sued the court, and I sued them. I went to the court, and the court said, clear cut. This banning was illegal, and it is illegal, totally illegal, to prevent Jews from praying on the Temple Mount. And the court said, guys, the Temple Mount is a very sensitive place. And this is what the police says. But the police said it's a sensitive place. We'll kick the Jews away from here. And the court said, no, it's a sensitive place. And therefore, you have to make sure, you have to establish criteria of behavior on the Temple Mount, which means anybody who knows how to respect the place, anybody who's willing to pray to God, should be allowed to do so. Anybody who wants to use the place, or I would say to exploit the place, and turn it into either a soccer field on the one hand, or a place which incites hate and terror, should not be there. Anybody who's trying to promote violence should not be there. And therefore, the court said obligated the government to compensate me for 500,000 shekel, half a million shekel, for the fact that they had banned me because I prayed on the Temple Mount. And this was this just happened just a month ago, and I'm very happy not because of the compensation, but because the decision of the court, which was very clear cut, which said to the police, guys, you can't run this place as if it's the Far West. You have to look at this place as a serious place and run it sensitively, like you do in a democratic country, with rules, with criteria, and of behavior.
Now, you've been against this directive not to let Jews and Christians pray on the Temple Mount, and you've done this peacefully. Yet, on the other side, there's been very violent aggression against you. In fact, you were just shot 3 times. We reported on our show widely, and were almost murdered by a terrorist because of the simple fact that you just want prayer for Jews and Christians on the Temple Mount. Tell us a little about that.
Thank you very much for that question, because it does. It brings me back to exactly a few months ago, just a block away from here, where I was concluding an annual convention, which we have, expressing, the title was Returning to the Temple Mount, Freedom to Pray, and hundreds of people came to this conference. And at the end of the conference, 10 p.m., I walked out, and somebody approached me on a motorcycle, said to me, you are an enemy of Islam, and he shot 4 bullets into the center of my body. Now, I want to really take the advantage of speaking to the audience of this program. Many people know me from around the world, know the Temple Mount Heritage Foundation, know the Liebe Project for Jewish Freedom on Temple Mount, and many, many people around the world, from all over the world, were expressing and praying for my health. I arrived to the hospital where the doctors were very pessimistic. They gave me from 2% to 5% chance to survive. I was in coma. And conscience for 10 days, and I know that all around the world, millions of people, those who knew me more or less, those who didn't know me at all, were cooperating in one thing, praying for my health. And thank you, and thank God for listening to those prayers. And once again, my hand is out to shake and to call for peace. And I do it with the Muslims. I cooperate with any kind of moderate Muslims who are willing to cooperate and say, yes, we respect the fact that others can pray here. Unfortunately, many of the radical Muslims in Israel and around the world, we know, are not yet used to Western values and don't know what tolerance is, don't know what respect is, don't know what human rights is all about. So I'm, thank God, I'm back alive. And we know when somebody dies early, we say, God probably thinks his mission was over. God left me here, which means that my mission is not over, and which means that we have to continue. And I call upon all of you, anybody who understands the concept of human rights, liberty, freedom, call in, help, and I'm sure there are many Christians out there who support this, many Jews out there who support this, and even many Muslims who support this. We're talking about the holiest place in the world. For all those billions of people in the world who believe in the Word of God, we're only saying, guys, let's do it together. Let's prove to the world that faith, that religion, is not a base, is not a foundation for violence and for war, but actually religion and faithfulness in God is a base for shalom, Shalom is the name of this city, Yerushalayim, Ir Shalom, and it's the name of God. Shalom is the name of God. And this is what we're talking about.
Thank you, Rabbi Glick, for being on the show. And thank you for tuning in to Ask the Source. I'm your host, Josh Reinstein. Now back to the studio.
Up next, Shining Light from Israel.
Well, this has been an incredible part of the trip to Israel, coming to the actual city of David, a place that I've heard about, you know, as long as I can remember, and to actually be able to touch a wall that is more than 2,000 years old, to see some of the ancient artifacts. You know, if anybody had doubts, you know, this should erase those doubts. I never had any doubts, so obviously it just fortifies the beliefs that I've had already.
What you're looking at today is the largest active excavation in Jerusalem.
It's a very humbling and very spiritual experience, and just fortifies your resolve to adopt the principles that God has set forth from the times of the early patriots, people like Abraham, and the faith that he manifested, and the blessings that were bestowed upon him, and recognize that if we adopt the ways that are good, as opposed to the ways that are bad, we can still be the recipients of God's blessings.
Please stay tuned for the ICEJ report from the International Christian Embassy, Jerusalem.
In 1980, the Israeli parliament passed a law declaring a united Jerusalem as the eternal capital of the State of Israel. Threatened by the Arab League with an oil embargo, national embassies in Jerusalem closed their doors. That same year, Christians from around the world gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. Sensing the isolation of the Israeli people, the participants and leaders of this gathering decided to establish the International Christian Embassy in Jerusalem.
The International Christian Embassy Jerusalem is since more than 30 years right here in Jerusalem to connect the global church with the nation of Israel. For many Jewish people throughout the centuries, the only face of Christianity, what they experienced, was the ugly face of anti-Semitism, of Christians persecuting the Jewish people wherever they found them. As Christian Embassy, we are here in Israel to show a new face of the church, a new face of Jesus Christ to the Jewish people. We are here to affirm to Israel and to the nation that God is a covenant-keeping God, that God is a God who didn't abandon his people, but that he is faithful to every single promise which he has made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
What an amazing thought that when everyone was abandoning Israel, Christians stepped in and said, we will stand with Israel and we will have an embassy in Jerusalem.
Already for more than 30 years, the International Christian Embassy Jerusalem is reaching out all over the land, from the north to the south, from the east to the west, to reach those people that are in need. And these people are, of course, the Jewish people who live in this land. But we've also been reaching out to the Christian Arab, to the Muslims, to the Bedouin, and to the Druze that are part of the population of Israel. Our vision
is to build relationships, to foster reconciliation, and to reach out with God's love by responding to the social needs that come across our desk every single day. Through the projects that we do, we hope to provide a better future for the people of Israel and to reach out with hope to those who need it most.
With representation in more than 80 countries around the globe, the ICEJ is actively working to be the connection of the Christian Church worldwide to Israel.
To say that we want to reach every country in the world, it's not just a saying, it's a mandate from God that we are to reach into every nation of the world, find those willing to represent their nation and stand with Israel in these days. It's prophetic, it's significant, and it's absolutely world-changing.
Through our publications, TV programs, digital media platforms, and annual events such as the celebration of the Feast of Tabernacles, we are providing resources and opportunity for the church to connect and engage in being an active part of what God is doing today in the nation of Israel.
You know, the truth is, the work of the ICEJ is more important now than it's ever been. With Israel at the eye of the Middle East storm, we must stand with Israel and we must stand with the Jewish people to see God move in our generation right here in the land.
It's so important to educate the church regarding Israel in the, from the Word of God and in the Bible. There's a lot of theory among the Christians speaking about Israel and a lot of opinions, but we do have to go to the Word of God with the revelation of the Holy Spirit, actually, so the church can really understand that without the Jewish people and without Israel, there wouldn't be any church, there wouldn't be any Bible, there wouldn't be any salvation.
I want to personally invite you to find out more how you can connect yourself or your church with the nation of Israel. I look forward to hearing from you.
To learn more about how you can connect with what God is doing today in Israel, visit our website at www.icej.org.
That's all for this edition of Israel Now News. I'm Yochanan Elrom.
And I'm Erin Viner, reporting from our studio in Jerusalem. Please join us again next week for all of your Israel updates.